Major funding for Battling Opioids has been provided by...
It doesn't take long to become addicted to opioids. In fact, 13 Pennsylvanians die from them every day. Geisinger is committed to ending opioid addiction with both prevention and treatment. In the last 3 years, we've reduced the amount of opioids we prescribe by 50%, and we've opened 3 medication-assisted treatment centers to help patients recover from addiction. Learn more at geisinger.org/hadenough.
Additional support has been provided by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and viewers like you. Thank you.
It could be your sister, your child, your parent, your grandparent, your neighbor, even your colleague. Opioids do not discriminate. The opioid crisis has become a nationwide issue. It was declared a public health emergency by President Trump in October 2017 and a disaster emergency in Pennsylvania by Governor Wolf in January of 2018. The CDC notes Pennsylvania is one of the 5 states hit hardest by the opioid epidemic, and it is seeing increases in overdoses across age groups, racial ethnic groups, and in urban and rural areas. In Pennsylvania, approximately 13 people die a day from an opioid overdose, according to a study from the University of Pittsburgh. Pennsylvania's 7 public media stations have joined together with the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania to confront this crisis head on. In this program, we'll tell compelling personal stories of hope and survival. In addition, we'll provide information and help direct people to the resources they need. After being involved in a serious car accident, Alexis Johnson was prescribed pain medication. She struggled with years of addiction, multiple overdoses, and jail sentences. Today, she is a successful model and a motivational speaker with a message that spreads hope. And for children with parents battling addiction, the crisis can be even harder to overcome. As the number of people struggling with opioid addiction increases, so does the number of children entering the foster care system. We sat down with a teenage girl who lost both parents to drug use. She ended up in the foster care system and has been struggling to find her way. Meet Alexis Johnson and Paris.
So I was born in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and I grew up in Archbold, Pennsylvania, and I had a beautiful upbringing. I had my life ahead of me. I came from a good family. There was really no drug use in my family. Where my life really took a turn for the worse was when opioids were introduced into my life. I was working at a bar in Scranton, and I was rushing to get to work. I was running late, and I hit a really bad rainstorm, and I hydroplaned. It was an extremely bad car accident. I was prescribed Xanax and Percocet for everything that had happened, and that's where I learned how to start abusing doctor-prescribed medication. In 2008, I didn't know anything about addiction. I wasn't aware of what was happening to my body. I just knew that I didn't have this pill, and I felt like garbage. So when I took the pills, I felt better. And then, you know, you get more pills and your dosage goes higher and then you start taking more. And at one point in time, I was actually getting over 600 Percocets a month, and it got ridiculously out of control. The pills weren't working anymore, so I ended up graduating to heroin. I started off sniffing it and eventually started shooting it. I would cry to God every day to take my life. I would sit in a mirror and just pick and pick. I actually took an X-Acto knife to my face and I cut my face here and all over. I have a massive scar. I look like the Night of the Living Dead. I was a walking corpse. My life now is awesome. At almost 3 years sober, it feels incredible. Fitness is such a huge passion of mine. I love bodybuilding, but I also love pushing myself way past limits. It breaks me down, it builds me up. It's cool because I've been able to smash a lot of barriers in the fitness world for recovering addicts. I did my first fitness competition in April of last year. It's WBFF, which stands for World Beauty Fitness and Fashion Federation. I came in top 15 for my first competition. I have been in numerous publications. I've been on the cover of magazines, and Status Fitness magazine did a huge article on me about my story. You know, the addiction used to be such a taboo, and now when I do these photo shoots, everybody wants to bring my story into it. My biggest modeling accomplishment, Playboy Australia 2018. I'm one of the first models that they were able to do the story on addiction. Everybody, including women, have supported it because of the integrity and my message and wanting to motivational speak and help teens. My goal in life is to help people and give back. What I've been through in my life is probably worse than most people have nightmares about. I've overcome so much. My only goal today is to make sure that kids don't walk down the same path I did.
A lot of my childhood has holes in it. I don't really remember. I remember pretty much the traumatic things more than the good things. I don't even think I could tell you one good thing about my childhood, to be honest with you. I saw a lot of things that I shouldn't have. I have seen things that I don't even think I should see now at my age. I went to parties with him because that was my dad, and I didn't want to be without him. I remember some days I would just wait by the window to see when he was coming home, and sometimes he didn't at all. Sometimes he stayed out. When I would go to parties, I think I would be the only kid there. He would be drunk and doing whatever, and there were some parties where like I just couldn't find him, and I was alone, and I can't imagine the things that could have happened to me.
We do not have enough families to meet the need because we need families for our teen population. Those are the ones that it's harder to find family for, because family will come forward for the newborns, and they'll come forward to the 4 and 5 year olds, but they're not coming forward to the 14 and 15 year olds. And all the agencies struggle with this.
I definitely had to get used to it because I wasn't used to the whole family aspect. And the kids just clung to me, and I wasn't really used to that either because I never really had healthy relationships.
She never got to be a kid, never. Now, my early childhood memory is Disney World. Her early childhood memory is calling a prison looking for her mom. So she went right from being a little child to doing adult things. And statistics say that, you know, she has an uphill battle. Statistics say teenage pregnancy, poverty, homelessness, drug abuse, alcoholism. So do I worry because I'm educated on what can happen? That's why I'm worried.
We really try to educate our families because they don't understand sometimes that you can take the child out of their environment and they can be with you 3 or 4 months, but that's not enough time, especially if you have a 14-year-old that maybe has been living in a situation that's been chaotic most of their lives. It's going to take a while to unpack that bag for them. It might take a year or more as they kind of adjust to your home and you adjust to them, and they don't feel safe a lot of times, so they challenge you for that. So it does take time to kind of help them and get the services they need and help them to know that this person is going to stay with them and not leave them. And that's ideally what we hope to get from our foster families, that they can just look at them and say, you know, there is no one like you, and I will always care for you. And that makes a huge difference.
Technology is now used in battling opioid addiction. Today, pharmacists can now lead the charge in helping those addicted to prescription pain medication get treatment thanks to prescription drug monitoring programs. But first, hear the story of a former well-known sportscaster from Philadelphia, Don Tollefson. After his addictions landed the famed television personality in prison, Tollefson wanted to find a way to give back.
Active addiction is a really bad horror movie. In my case, the fact that I could go on television and do the sports or the news after I had consumed alcohol and or drugs continually convinced my addictive mind and my delusional mind that I was okay. My name is Don Tollefson, and I'm a recovering alcoholic, drug addict, and an ex-felon. I came to Action News in 1975, was there for 15 years, and then worked for the Philadelphia Eagles as a preseason play-by-play announcer and a stadium announcer until 2012. I was making terrible decisions. I had a big gulp of vodka with a little tonic, and I'd start popping pills, and I started over-promoting what it was I could do for the donors. And all of a sudden in 2013, I realized that that I was in a position where I couldn't come through on these trips and these tickets that I owed them. Some people went to the police, and I was indicted by the grand jury. I was charged with two felonies of theft by deception.
I am Shauna Roeder, and we're in Harleysville, Pennsylvania. My parents had started a ministry for inmates, and they knew that he was in prison, so they reached out to him after he got out of prison. My mom knew what he was doing, trying to help people with addiction, so she reached out to him, hoping that he could help me with my addiction.
Originally, I got to know Don just on TV. Then when I heard that he was incarcerated, my wife and I have been doing a ministry called Cellmate Bible Ministry.
As any inmate knows, mail is a huge, huge thing when you're in prison. It's something you so look forward to every day. Lois and Gary put out an incredibly inspiring newsletter, and it made a huge, huge difference in my attitude while I was incarcerated. It brought hope. And when they presented me with the opportunity to work with Shauna, I felt very honored by that.
I wasn't ready for the help. I just wanted to keep doing what I was doing.
She's been struggling pretty much with alcohol for several years, and we've been seeing a positive change in her life, but it's really the last several months that she's been in contact with Don. She's been growing in the right direction, in a positive direction.
In prison, you have an enormous amount of time in your cell to think about your life. And I said, you know, when the opportunity presents itself, once I'm released, I'd like to see, you know, would I be comfortable having a street ministry to help addicted people?
Let's get something to eat first.
My name is Jasmine Johnson. We are in Kensington area of Philadelphia. This is what we would call Needle Park. I was on the streets of Kensington for 6 years. Six long years. And when I got here, it was like a big playground of drugs, you know, and partying and fun. We ran these streets all around Kensington, doing whatever we needed to get what we needed to get high. I went to jail. The judge sentenced me to go to a program, to a rehab. From there, I was put on methadone, and then I got pregnant with a sugar daddy, you would call it. And I told myself I needed to get it together. I had to learn how to stay sober.
I met Jasmine along with her boyfriend and Aiden, her three-year-old child. And it was at a time when they were going to methadone treatment at 8th and Girard, but they were homeless.
He came and met us one morning. He met Aiden. Fell in love with him. We talked, you know, just getting to know each other. You know, a lot of addicts feel that we're stuck here. Like, it's just a loop that you can't get out of. It's just this is my life and I'm gonna be like this till I die. He told me that I could still do more with my life. It's very important to have a support group. It's so hard to do it on your own because cravings are gonna come. You're gonna have using dreams. You're gonna have triggers. I could be walking down the street and I see a little cut off block. Wow, you know, that would be a good spot. The number one thing, you do not want to isolate because your mind is extremely powerful and addiction is cunning.
Having somebody that went through addiction helps me because they know what it's like to struggle. They're not judgmental at all because family for a long time was kind of judgmental and said, you know, just stop.
Be available to someone you've met who's struggling with addiction. Be a good listener. Don't come to someone on the streets of Kensington or North Philly or Germantown and say, hey, here's what you need to do. Ask them what they want to do.
Years ago, I was much more judgmental. I've grown to realize that now everything isn't just black and white, cut and dry. Nobody can help them. They have to do it on their own. And until they're ready to take help and move forward, there's nothing you can do. It's quite a struggle. And to see a person get down to the bottom and work their way up, it's really something special.
Prescription drug monitoring programs are seen as one of the tenets to fighting prescription drug abuse across the country. In our state in Pennsylvania, our Department of Health now oversees it. And basically, when pharmacies dispense a controlled substance, whether it be a Schedule 2, 3, 4, or 5, and that covers all your opioids pretty much, it covers all your benzodiazepines, it covers any controlled substance, they have to report it to a state database. And that state database then collects, you know, okay, here's these drugs that were dispensed at all the pharmacies across the state. Here's the prescribers that prescribed them. And they have to report that within about a day. So it's kind of real time, if you will. So now what happens is you have all this data in there. It can be used by law enforcement if there's ever a concern, but also prescribers and pharmacists now have access to that and they can go in. So if I have a patient, let's say as a pharmacist that comes in, there's gonna be times that I have to query this data depending on what's going on, or I can if I think there's a concern. So what happens is I can go in and see, are people going to multiple doctors and getting multiple prescriptions, you know what I mean, that might interact or might lead to an overdose, or maybe they are doctor shopping and abusing. So it helps catch those kinds of issues, but it also helps clinically as well too. And then doctors that are prescribing can also go on and see too if they've ever gotten anything. Now one of the issues is every state has their own database, okay? So where we are in Erie, we're half hour from Ohio, we're half hour from New York. So prior, people could cross state lines and we didn't know what was going on. But now the states are starting to share data. So I think Pennsylvania now shares with about 16 states. So I can even see when they're going now to Ohio doctors and getting a controlled substance in New York or getting it filled there or whatever as well too. So what happens with the PDMPs is the pharmacist or the doctor or the prescriber can go into this while the patient's there or before they see them or while they're attempting to fill their prescription, and they can see what's going on, and that information can be analyzed by the practitioner. And then that can kind of, it's a tool in their decision-making process. So if the pharmacist would see, oh wait, you're going to three other doctors and you're getting two other medications, before I fill this one, I want to talk to these other doctors and make sure that you need all these together or something like that. Or maybe the prescriber queries it and sees, wait a minute, you're also on this medication or something, you know what I mean? So depending on what's going on, if it's truly a clinical problem, then the healthcare providers can communicate. If it's an issue where someone thinks that they're addicted or that they're doctor shopping or something like that, that could be the first step to talk to them about possible treatment or something as well, too.
Decisions that addicts make can affect their children for the rest of their lives. We'll visit Hogar Korea in Freemansburg, where addicts submit to an intense treatment program aimed at restoring the whole person and reclaiming lives. But first, let's meet Lisa Nye, who used heroin until she discovered she was pregnant at 23 weeks, and her baby, who was born dependent on opioids. Stigma prevents some pregnant women from seeking help, the very help that saved the lives of Lisa and her baby.
My preemie baby went through withdrawal. She's 5 days old. Her name is Isabella. I'm in the methadone program, and she's born addicted to the methadone. It was hard to watch her shake and tremor. She receives morphine to help with her withdrawal a few times a day. The third day was the hardest. Yesterday would have been day 4, and it was better, but today's probably the best day. It's day 5. We both started using together, and then from the Percocet, they're expensive, and that led to heroin. Heroin's cheap, and it was just snowball effect. It was horrible. He's incarcerated for some of the stuff that the opiates caused him to do. Waking up, it's a struggle. All you can think about is, how am I not going to be sick today? How am I going to get the money? What do I have to do to get that money? It's disgusting. It's not a way of life. I wouldn't wish it on anybody. And I used up until I found out I was pregnant with her, and I was 23 weeks along. Just because of the judgmental people out there, like, she's using and she's pregnant, but when you're pregnant and you're using, you can't stop. I was ashamed because I was using while pregnant. I was scared. I didn't want people to know, because I don't want someone to take my child from me because of a choice I made and now I'm an addict. I'm in treatment with roughly 6 to 8 women. There's probably hundreds of them out there, and they're scared. They don't want to be judged. They don't want that fear of their baby getting taken away. I just wanted to do whatever it took. I'm over 90 days sober. I feel good. I don't know. Seeing your child through sober eyes is, it's awesome. She knows that we were sick and we had to go to a special hospital with special doctors. But I'm ready to have her back and let my mom be a grandma again instead of a mom. I'm excited because I'm sober. As soon as I find housing, like, I get to, we can be a family again, and it's like a second chance. I can start over, like a clean slate.
Before I came in here, I had a couple months. I was just out on the street after they took my daughter away. I struggled getting clean and staying clean for my whole life. So, my name is Jeremy Wheaton. I'm 35 years old. I'm from Palmerton, Pennsylvania. I came here about 22 months ago. They opened the doors, welcomed me. You know, I was resistant at first, but you know, as soon as I started, you know, submitting to the program and doing what I had to do, I started changing everything about myself.
Hogar Korea is a therapeutic community. We call it Hogar, meaning home. And create the Center for the Reeducation of the Character. That's what we call holder career. After 20 months, we guarantee if they go through the process, you will have a new member of the society that would know what is the role in society, you know? That, you know, they have to learn how to get familiar with the rules and regulations of the programs.
How you doing, Pedro?
All right.
Your surgery all right?
A little bit more better.
All right. A little more better. Hogarth Cray, Freemansburg, Brian speaking. How can I help you? And how much is the fee? What makes this program different is that, like I said, you're doing it for yourself. And they put it all on you. It's your accountability, your responsibility to do anything in the program. They're not going to force you to do anything at all, but they want you to take initiative to do the things that you need to do to better your life. Well, it's designed to make a structure out of your life, to have accountability and responsibility. We do work brigades. We go and do landscaping brigades. We do moving brigades. We work at warehouses. We do the sale of our baked goods. We do everything. Everything we can think of.
You are in charge of a whole home, not just yourself. You got 20 residents or more that you have to take care of and make sure that everything gets done the way it's supposed to. You have to manage, you know, the house. You gotta make sure bills are paid. You gotta make sure that the guys are getting therapies and, you know, you're managing the food, everything, you know. I have a little girl that I'm gonna be taking care of, so it really taught me that, okay, I can take care of our house, I can take care of her. When you go to another facility, they don't give you that much responsibility. One, it made me feel good that people were trusting me again. When you're in addiction, you lose a lot of trust from a lot of people. I think in recovery, you need that part too. That really helps to have that responsibility, to be able to know that you can do this. You need to have that responsibility, take care of things.
With opiate addiction, it takes 18 months to actually rid it of yourself. That's why longevity here it's really important, because if you're not gonna be here for long term, you're not gonna change. This was the first program that would accept me as a long-term solution to my problem. But you have to be strong. If you're not, I mean, what's the point of being here? Until someone says, look, I've had enough. And when they do, this place is waiting. It's always going to be here.
Living in isolated rural counties of Pennsylvania poses unique challenges to those seeking treatment. Medication-assisted treatment is called the gold standard of addiction care by its advocates. However, negative public perceptions surround this form of treatment. We'll travel to Center County to meet Jamie Durst, who discusses receiving the treatment she describes as life-changing. But first, hear the story of one community agency that is working to make recovery treatment more effective for those who choose that path.
In a rural community, if you're seeking treatment for an addiction problem, one of the biggest barriers is simply locating a provider who can help you and then getting to the provider.
In northeastern Pennsylvania, there's only a handful of licensed step-down services.
Just for example, in Susquehanna County, there are two sites where there's addiction recovery counseling available, one in Montrose and one in Susquehanna. But if you live any place else in that county and you want help for that problem, you've got a lot of traveling to do. I know that someone had wanted to open an addiction recovery center in Susquehanna prior to the hospital opening one, and they ran into some pushback from the local community.
There is that not in my backyard mentality. I don't want those type of people coming into my backyard. Those individuals are already here in your community. They're just untreated.
Addicts are a hugely diverse group of people. Upper class, lower class, doesn't make a big difference.
In northeastern Pennsylvania, it wasn't taking place in bedroom communities. Well, now all of a sudden it did.
And a lot of patients are started on prescription medications, but not by a doctor. They go to a party and somebody's got a bottle of prescription medications and they're passing them out. And that's how a lot of people get started.
It's not a walk-away drug. Your body becomes physically dependent on those medications.
It's not a question of getting high anymore. This is a question of just feeling normal. We've partnered with the local drug and alcohol counseling program, which is called TREHAB. This guy comes into the emergency room, he's had an overdose. And in the old days, the ER doctor, which might be me, would get him through his overdose, and we'd give him some recovery material, call these people in the morning, and about 40% of those people might actually make the phone call the next morning and try to get some recovery. A warm handoff is a relatively new term. That same person comes in, and as soon as they're identified as someone has an addiction issue, they pick up the phone and call the certified recovery specialist. And those people show up, start the counseling immediately. If medication is needed, you provide the medication then. So instead of hoping they'll call tomorrow and get them in, you get in and you get started right away. You get about an 80% response rate instead of a 40% response rate.
Even when you have treatment services available across the street, the engagement level has a lot to do with the individual's willingness to want to get help.
If you're thinking about pursuing recovery and you haven't made that step yet, call one of the counseling programs. Get in, get evaluated. You may find out that it's something you want to do that very day, or you may decide, I'm going to keep talking to them, it sounds good. Maybe I'll turn around in a week or a month. If you don't pick up the phone and call a counselor, get in and see a counselor, then the next time you get in to see someone is going to be when you overdose, when you go to jail, when your family says you can't come home anymore.
You don't realize how great it is when you're able to be the person you're supposed to be.
If you have enough motivation to even call a counselor, they can usually help you out.
Addiction is a brain disorder. It is a disease, and I know a lot of people challenge that. If someone could stop that easily, they would. Nobody wants to be controlled 24/7 by a drug that they're spending so much time and money chasing and obsessed with to make them feel normal.
For me to describe withdrawal, it is basically having flu symptoms times 100. You get the headaches, and then you have the chills, and then, you know, you have bowel problems, and, you know, you're vomiting.
Seeing a person go through opiate withdrawal is a pretty horrific experience, and it isn't something you would wish on anyone. Medicated-assisted treatment is using a medication to help those who suffer with opioid use disorder. It helps with their cravings and withdrawal symptoms. It allows them to focus and function normally and allows them to engage in treatment better so we can begin their recovery process.
I didn't get hooked on drugs and alcohol till later on in life, till I was like 28 years old. And I don't know how that started. It was just some of the people that I was hanging with, and I would like, oh, I would try it. And then all of a sudden, like, it became really bad. I actually Googled doctors in the State College area, and this number came up, and I was desperate, so I called it. I'm like, I need help. Like, and it's hard to ask for help, you know? I take two a day. I take one in the morning and like one in the afternoon. I don't get high off of it. Like, when, if you're doing it the right way and you're on this program and you're doing it right, you don't get high off of anything. You don't want to. Like, that's the whole purpose of not coming to here, you know, like, is not to get high.
Coming in for medicated assisted treatments, we don't look at just giving the client medication. We look at the patient as a whole. In addition to the medication, there is also individual therapy, and then there's group therapy that goes along with that. All the data shows that for opioid use disorder, you have a higher rate of achieving recovery and staying in recovery long-term with medicated-assisted treatment coupled with therapy. I've seen success in the other levels of care, but I haven't seen long-term success like I see in medicated-assisted treatment.
Since I've been on it, I've gotten a house, I have my car, and I've worked at my job for 3.5 years. Like, that's awesome. but I'm a different person. So you have to just make yourself a better person every day. You know what I mean? You got to live with the moment. Sometimes it takes minute by minute, second by second, but you just got to get up and just try to be the better person than you were before the next day. That's what I do.
Is opioid abuse dependency genetic? Could the proper disposal of medications help curb this epidemic? Coming up, you'll meet Brenda Goldman, a mom who not only battled addiction, but now has kids who suffer as well. Could a test detect if someone is at risk for developing a drug dependency? But first, find out why drug take-back boxes are an important focus on alleviating concerns of prescription drug abuse by helping us properly dispose of unused prescription medications.
So medication disposal is also one of the major ways to try and help deal with the epidemic. There's lots of ways to deal with the epidemic, right? Like I said, there's enforcement, there's treatment, there's prevention. So one of the issues is, and there's studies out there that shows that, let's say you or myself go and get a medication because we had a root canal or something, and we maybe got 30 pain medications, pills, and we only use like 3 or 5 of them. And if we leave those laying around our house, that's a source of diversion. It might be someone in your family, it might be friends that visit you, it might be someone that comes to work in your house or something like that. So really, we want people to get medication out of their home that they no longer need or using or are expired. And there's some people out there that have a lot of medication in their home, like if they have cancer or something like that, they have a lot of pain medications. Now there's a lot of attention put on what's the best way to dispose of medication. So taking the environmental factors, taking the fact that we want people to dispose of medications as soon as they can. And it's just not controlled substances, it's really any medications. So basically, whenever patients or people are done with their medications, we want them to dispose of them. So these boxes are a way for them to bring it to us at local law enforcement. It's a couple pharmacies around our town have them as well. They're around the state. The state attorney general has funded some at a lot of the state police barracks as well too. They can drop it off there. Then those are collected currently through the National Guard, and then they are incinerated. And incineration is much safer for the environment, and it's paid for as well, I think, through the state. So the whole philosophy is get unneeded medications out of the home because we don't want people diverting them, abusing them, or maybe having a poisoning issue with them or whatever. And then that's probably the best way for the environment as well. And across our state, probably since around 2010 or 11 or so, there's been this heightened attention on best disposal practices. And then when these boxes started and we were advertising them and stuff, as well as the DEA does a take back event twice a year too, and it's the same thing kind of as the box. You know, we would see more and more drugs come in every time. We were just shocked, and I think this last DEA take back that they had was the most that they ever collected as well too. So I think as a society, people are listening and they're realizing, oh, this is something important not only for me to help protect against poisonings, diversion, the environment, everything. So I think in general, most people are very sensitive to it and they want to do the right thing. So yeah, we've continued to see it be used. And at first we thought it would kind of dip down, but there's always drugs being prescribed, always people cleaning out their cabinets, if you will. People go through issues like, you know, acute illnesses or whatever. So it has really been a good program that has continued to collect a lot of medications each time, and it doesn't seem to be slowing down.
The question is, why are people developing dependency? Some people developing dependency, others aren't. What's the difference? For instance, as little as 3 days of an oral opioid into 1 year, 1 in 16 to 1 in 10 of patients are going to be dependent upon that drug. Why is that?
When I was about 15, I started drinking. And then as I graduated from school, then it went into marijuana, the cocaine, the crack, the Quaaludes. So I was an abuser. I was an abuser of drugs and alcohol. I have 9 boys and 2 girls. My oldest son struggles with heroin, and he really struggled with that for about 10, 12 years. Started with opiates in school. And then I have another son who really struggled with marijuana and opiates. And then I have another son who also dabbles with the opiates.
Each of them have been in and out of jail and in recovery. And I can say today, though, they are doing quite well.
It's well known and well characterized in the already peer-reviewed literature that somewhere in the neighborhood of 50% of substance use disorders can be due to genetics.
Come on.
LifeKit Predict is a branded name of a very specific test. And it doesn't tell you definitively that you will develop a substance use disorder. What it does do is objectively allows classification of a patient based upon their genes alone as similar to a group with an opioid use disorder or not. What we're working through right now is how you go through and use that information to appropriately change clinical practice.
When a loved one is using, it has such a stronghold on them. They walk away from family, they walk away from everything they know to continue to satisfy that craving that has a grip. Here I am, I abused drugs. And when trouble came, I had the sense to and the ability to say, okay, you know what? I gotta walk away from this. Enough, it's over, time to grow up. My sons can't do that. It is not my oldest son's desire to not have a full life.
We truly believe in shared decision making, allowing a patient and a provider to have a discussion where they can objectively understand what the differences in clinical pathways are. We think it would be interesting to have the patient-provider discussion. Your genes are very similar to a group with an opioid use disorder. Let's talk about how that may affect you. Let's talk about how that may decide different pathways here in your care. And we believe that this test is an objective classifier that should be there when that discussion is happening.
If you could have that testing and then prescribe the right pain medication, I think it would be such a benefit to our society in this epidemic.
When a person is overdosing on an opioid, breathing can slow down or even stop, and it can be very hard to wake him or her. Naloxone or Narcan is an opiate antidote. Eric Phillips owes his life to naloxone. He's been revived multiple times with the overdose antidote, which is accessible to most people in Pennsylvania at pharmacies. This segment explains what happens to the body when someone uses opioids and how the antidote can reverse the effect of an opioid overdose.
I am Eric Phillips. I'm a recovering addict and alcoholic. There's probably been times that I've had got naloxone used on me that I don't even know. It probably was needed. It could have saved my life.
Narcan is the life-saving drug for individuals when they have overdosed from an opiate, and it can reverse the effects of the overdose and literally bring someone back to life.
Naloxone is the generic name. Narcan is the brand name that it's sold under.
A standing order takes away one of the hardest things that an individual needs to get a prescription medication, and that's the actual prescription. Normally, if someone needs to get a prescription medication, they have to call their doctor, go visit their doctor, get that piece of paper, or have their doctor call it in or send in an order, and then go to the pharmacy and get it. With the standing order, that whole step is bypassed.
I think the standing order is a great thing. We want to make sure that as many people who need naloxone are able to get naloxone.
You know, and I know there's probably mixed views about it. People saying, oh, if it's available, they can use more. And everybody does that with everything, whether it's a cell phone or it's whatever.
I think it's a good idea. Certainly, if there's any way to save someone who's overdosing, then you want to give them another chance.
Treatment's not going to work if you're dead. So by saving somebody with naloxone, you're giving that individual, that family, one more opportunity to go into treatment.
As a physician, I saw this as a really tangible tool that could be put to immediate use in the fight against this disease. It took some readjustment for folks, but now I think that, you know, there's a relative, I'm not going to say it's perfect, but I think a relatively smooth process out there for most people. The individual would literally just go up to the pharmacy counter and say, I would like a prescription of naloxone. And the pharmacy would get their name. They do have to take the person's name, and then if they have some kind of insurance, whatever it is, it can be Medicaid or any of the private health insurers, they would need that insurance information. Or the person could choose to just pay cash. That's pretty much it.
It is a simple procedure to use this medication.
There's the intranasal, so that's what we use, and then there's the injectable. So the injectable works similar to like an EpiPen, but we distribute the intranasal.
The intranasal method is simple, and anyone can do that.
It's a very small unit, 2 squirts up the nose.
The intranasal method takes anywhere from 2 to 5 minutes to work.
If the person is not breathing, the spray will work because it is absorbed in the membrane of the nose.
I think it's a good thing to have. Family members of addicts or people who abuse prescription medication should have it with them.
As long as it is an opiate that you think that that person is abusing, an individual should have Narcan on hand for that person.
I think it's important that people understand better what naloxone, what Narcan is, what it can do. And they should avail themselves of the opportunity to use it.
So, you know, over the last, say, 15 years here in town, we've used to see a surge of heroin and some opiates at one point in time, then it really fizzled out, and then it's really come back with a vengeance over the past, say, maybe 5 years or so. And probably the last 2 years, it's really become to surmountable levels. More and more, we're seeing younger patients coming through who are in cardiac arrest, and no matter what we can do, you can't bring people back from the dead generally. Now, they will wake up with the antidote that's on the street, you know, that we've made much more available for folks, but there's gonna be a point in time in a condition when that antidote doesn't work for that patient. And just because an antidote's out there doesn't give somebody liberal use to then go start using the drugs because the antidotes are around on the street. Again, if people use a certain amount of the drug, the antidote won't work. So how an overdose happens can happen just by ingesting pills, snorting, injecting, popping, and so on. The antidote potentially works up in the brain cells to block the receptor where that prescription drug or opiate or heroin is going to work, and basically blocks that effect of the drug. And if a patient is essentially apneic, meaning not breathing, it'll wake them up very quickly. But again, it's only at a point in time where other effects haven't happened. If it's too late in the game, it would essentially not have an effect because the metabolic changes in your body would already occur to lead you to death. So it does have benefit. It works either through an injection. They can give it to you down a tube. You can actually use a nasal spray that they have today. And it is very effective. But again, its effectiveness has to be out there with a caution that just because you have an effective drug to treat your overdose shouldn't give you the comfort that you can overdose and someone's going to save your life. There will be people that die because the antidote is not strong enough or doesn't have enough time to work because whatever you did already took effect.
Throughout the past hour, you've heard stories of struggle, but also stories of those who are now in a much better place. For them, staying clean is hard work and a source of great pride. Where do they go to stay on the right track? Well, in Washington, Pennsylvania, Chris's room bears the name of a young man who inspired it. Overcoming opioid addiction is no easy task, but in this next segment, you'll see how through community support, hobbies, and personal strength, there is hope for recovery.
I'm Beth, and this is Bill, our mom and dad of our son, Chris Wall. This picture was taken of him when he was graduating from high school, but tragically, Chris died when he was 33 years old from a heroin fentanyl overdose. He went to Penn State and graduated with an industrial engineering degree.
We wanted to be upfront because there's no sense hiding from it. It's a disease. Chris touched a lot of people, and they saw the obituary and wanted to contribute.
So this room was created in the memory of our son, Chris, as a place of respite for people who are in treatment for addiction.
There were gaps during the course of treatment, and I think this room helps kind of bridge that gap. You cannot allow people to go in for 3 days for detox and maybe 3 weeks, and then you're out on the street again.
This room is a safe place for me. I've seen people sleeping in here, people doing their laundry, showering, eating, and just being able to sit down and talk to someone, listening to someone, giving them advice is hugely beneficial to me and my recovery.
It's just so nice to have this back here. You know, even just to find a book and sit and read the book and, you know, relax for a minute.
These stones, which represent loved ones who have been lost as a result of drug abuse, this stone right here with Jessica written on it. Jessica was an ex-girlfriend of mine who died of a heroin overdose. Lots of things trigger my anxiety, and you know, coming to this room, you know, I'm able to get away from the hustle and bustle of everyday life.
I come here just to get out of the cold. There's always, you know, a place to rest.
People call people in Chris's situation, they call them junkies. And junkie is a terrible term to use for someone who's battling addiction, battling a disease.
Remember, Chris says, I just hate people looking at me like I'm broke.
The bottom line is we have to get rid of the stigma so that people can seek the treatment that they need and the support from everyone around them.
It's a tragedy what happened to the son, but for them to do something, such a great memory of him, to help out someone like me.
Even though they lost their son, they're still willing to help other people in recovery.
If this place wasn't here, I don't know where I'd be. I might be dead right now.
It makes me proud, in a sense, that he touched so many lives. If there's anything good that can come of this, maybe this is it.
I think he'd love this.
He would.
I think he'd think it would be awesome.
My name is Joey Pagano, and I've been clean since February 1st, 2013. When I was young, I used to play the guitar, and I played acoustic guitar for a long time, and I lost that hobby. Once I got clean and I started on that path, and I played guitar, and that hobby kept me going for such a long time.
My name is Janae DeCantis. I've been clean since January 5th, 2010. I really would just reach out to other people and say, hey, like, I really don't know if I can stay clean today. Like, can you help me? I really had to have somebody literally hold my hand until I didn't have those urges as much anymore.
My name is Danny Connell. I have 1,218 days clean. I vape a lot. You know, like, it's more of like a hobby now for me. I like to travel, like, go to conventions. I have a lot of passion behind it, you know, and I mean, honestly, that's honestly what I do.
My name is Mindy McCloy. I've been clean since January 29, 2014. I stay clean for myself, but whenever there's days that I have, you know, it's really tough to get through, I look at my daughter and she's like, puts a smile back on my face.
My name is Brian Issy, and I've been clean for almost 4 years now. My hopes going forward, I hope to show people that, you know, recovery is possible, and, you know, I didn't feel like I could go and open up about what I was dealing with, so I tried to hide it. So I want to show people that, you know, there's a place you can go.
By the
the grace of God, I've been clean and sober since February the 6th, 2015. I missed out on a lot of key events in my daughter's life. Our relationship today, I can't say enough about it. It's beautiful. My first Mother's Day card she gave me that said, "I love you, Mom," made me cry because I didn't know she could ever feel that way about me.
My name is Chelsea Hill. I've been clean for 8 years. I go to the gym almost every morning, which sounds kind of silly, but it's a great time for me to, like, get recentered with myself.
It's a beautiful thing to get clean, but it's an even more beautiful thing to help somebody and, like, be able to watch them get clean.
And I remember, like, I wanted to just make a difference one time, not only in my life, let my family be able to sleep, you know, and just live a life where my parents, myself, and God could be proud of me.
Over the past hour, you have seen incredible personal stories of courage and hope. We are now going to take a short break, and when we return, we'll tell you what resources are available in Pennsylvania in the battle against opioid addiction.
Major funding for Battling Opioids has been provided by...
It doesn't take long to become addicted to opioids. In fact, 13 Pennsylvanians die from them every day. Geisinger is committed to ending opioid addiction with both prevention and treatment. In the last 3 years, we've reduced the amount of opioids we prescribe by 50%, and we've opened 3 medication-assisted treatment centers to help patients recover from addiction. Learn more at geisinger.org/hadenough.
Additional support has been provided by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and viewers like you. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Paola Giangiacomo. Tonight's program is the first collaborative effort in which all 7 Pennsylvania public media organizations are using each of our media platforms to bring awareness to the opioid epidemic. We are uniting to show you how Pennsylvanians statewide are confronting the epidemic of heroin and prescription opioid abuse by increasing awareness and empathy to reduce the stigma surrounding addiction. If you or a family member or a friend are in need of help, call the Pennsylvania Get Help Now hotline at 1-800-662-HELP. Now, we'll introduce our panel. We have Jennifer Smith, who was appointed Secretary of Drug and Alcohol Programs in March of 2018. Since assuming the role of secretary, she has led the department's focus on strengthening Pennsylvania's drug and alcohol treatment landscape by increasing drug take-back opportunities, launching Pennsylvania's Get Help Now hotline, and expanding access to naloxone in communities around Pennsylvania. Don Tollefson is a former Philadelphia sportscaster who knows he couldn't have gotten sober in prison without help. Now, he mentors and counsels people who are dealing with substance abuse issues. Jeremy Wheaton is a former resident and director of Hogar Crea in Freemansburg, Pennsylvania, which is a nonprofit organization dedicated to offering preventative and treatment services to people struggling with addiction. Steve Ross is from the Luzerne, Wyoming County's Drug and Alcohol Program. Steve works closely with drug and alcohol officials at both the county and statewide levels. Now we'll begin our discussion. I want to thank you all for being here today. You saw the one-hour program that we showed you before we went live here on the air. And one of the stories that you saw is that in the rural counties of Pennsylvania, treatment centers aren't that readily available, and people who need help have to travel a far distance. We have Jen Smith on the phone. She works with the state. She manages the website and also the 1-800 hotline number. Jen, can you tell us what the state is doing to help combat this epidemic? It's gotten worse and worse over the years. And like we said, there is a hotline and treatment centers, but not all of them are easily accessible. Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. Thanks, Paola, so much for having me this evening and giving the opportunity to talk about such an important topic. So in terms of rural areas, we know that there is a significant shortage of treatment availability. So one of the programs that our administration has been working on is called Establishing PACMAT Models, which stands for Pennsylvania Coordinated Medication-Assisted Treatment. And it's a model where we utilize treatment at primary care physician sites, and the primary care physicians utilize an addiction medicine specialist at a hub in order to consult and provide those treatment services. So what it really does is extends the reach of treatment providers into primary care physician sites, which is fantastic for rural communities. In terms of accessing treatment, really the best couple of places to go are obviously the hotline. It's available 24/7, 365. It's staffed with individuals who have lived addiction experience, so they can assist in finding you a treatment facility. The other wonderful place to go is your local single county authority, and you can locate that by going to our website on the Pennsylvania Department of Drug and Alcohol Program. And Steve Ross is one of those single county authorities. He's joining us this evening, so he might have more details to share. But those entities across the state are really fantastic at navigating the treatment system, understanding insurance, and ensuring that patients really get to the spot that they need to get to in order to get the best treatment.
Okay. You mentioned Steve Ross is here with us, and you work on the treatment side, but you're also working with other agencies in Luzerne and Wyoming counties to bring all these agencies together, and you've started an initiative, the Stop Coalition. Mm-hmm. Could you tell us about that?
Yes, we have two opioid coalitions. We have one specific to Luzerne County called the Stop Coalition and one in Wyoming County called the Hope Coalition, because what we found is that there are differences, geographic differences, cultural differences, socioeconomic differences that make the coalitions needing to be on a county-wide, a county-specific basis. And the beauty of the coalition is that we're able to bring all the key stakeholders to the table. What we've recognized is that the opioid crisis is a community-wide problem, and that being said, it's going to take the whole community to solve it. So we've brought a group of stakeholders together that represent drug and alcohol, the district attorney, the coroner, law enforcement, probation, judges, hospitals, behavioral health specialists, treatment specialists, prevention specialists. And so these coalition efforts through a three-year strategic plan, we're able to develop subcommittees and target those short-term, intermediate-term, and long-term goals that we know it's going to take to solve the opioid epidemic.
Great. If you, the 1-800 number is on your screen. If you or someone you know needs help, you could see the number 1-800-662-HELP. We've been talking about getting help. It's not always easy for someone who needs help to seek help. Some people don't know where to go or where to start. You saw Jeremy Wheaton's story earlier tonight. And Jeremy, we were talking earlier, and you said if it wasn't for Hogar Korea in Freemansburg, you may not be in recovery right now. So let's talk about the facility where you've been for almost the last 2 years and how it's helped you get back on the right track.
Well, I started out in the Allentown Hogar on 4th Street in Allentown. I had nowhere else to go. It was going to take too long to get into treatment, and I needed help.
You needed help because you were on opiates.
Because I knew I was on a bad, I was on a bad track.
And heroin.
Yes. So they took me in that day. I mean, I had nowhere to go. It was either I went there or I was going to go back out on the streets.
And how has that place helped you?
I mean, I was resistant at first. I didn't want to change. You know, there was things about me that I thought I liked, but I realized that I really had to change, like, solid things, not just stop using drugs. I had to change my whole character.
And you have a daughter that...
Correct.
You want to get back to taking care of.
Correct. So, yeah, I mean, she's my main focus. She really drives me every day to try to be a better person, better man, try to help others. There's nothing more gratifying than to be able to help another addict. I mean, to me, that's rewarding in itself.
And Don, that's what you're doing today. First of all, I grew up watching you. I grew up in Philadelphia. You're a sportscaster at Action News, WPVI, and then you went on to announce for the Eagles in Philadelphia. You've been on TV for years, but you had an issue with substance abuse, but you got help. And now you're helping others.
Yeah, and I want to commend Jen and Steve and obviously Jeremy as well, but the coordination, the teamwork that is now available to the addicts that I work with on the street or ones that are referred to me often through social media is really, really incredible. And one of the examples of teamwork that I think needs to be more publicized is that when an addict overdoses and goes to the hospital and fortunately does not die, these emergency rooms in the inner city are so, so busy. We're now concentrating on something that most people refer to as a warm handoff, where if the person survives before they're discharged, they have an opportunity to meet with social workers and counselors and get resources made available to them immediately. So they go back out onto the streets without having to live on the streets necessarily. They can get outpatient treatment. They can get into recovery houses and all. And I really, really think one of the things that can really help the process in terms of reversing the opioid epidemic is that the families and loved ones and coworkers of people who may just start having a problem, and it's an awareness that these people have that this person may be headed down the wrong path. The earlier you make an effort on their behalf to take advantage of these resources, and the battlingopioids.org website is a fabulous place now to go, the quicker you're going to be able to get that person to stop before it becomes life-threatening.
And speaking of warm handoffs, Steve, you've been knocking on doors at hospitals all over Luzerne and Wyoming counties to institute this warm handoff, and it's finally happening, but it wasn't easy.
No, it wasn't. You know, the hospitals are charged with their priority is triaging people and dealing with what's presenting at that moment from a physical standpoint, and so attacking that behavioral piece to it and it has been difficult, but we've been knocking on the hospital's doors over and over, and we've finally gained some legs, and we are seeing successes with warm handoff referrals coming to us, and they're showing up at the ER, and there's an ability for them to contact the SCA or our designee. We're able to do that over the phone screening, determining that need for detox, arrange for treatment in a facility, and an attempt to arrange for transportation door to door, because we know if that person is triaged or stabilized in the ER and discharged with some paperwork, the odds of them coming and following up for treatment are greatly diminished. So if we can get to them right at that point, and like the other presenters said, you know, it's at that point, you know. When someone is ready, you have to get to them then, you know.
And in addition to the StopCoalition.org initiative, you're also working to open treatment centers in Luzerne County. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, recovery support centers. We're working on an initiative with our local MCO, the Northeast Behavioral Healthcare Consortium, and some reinvestment dollars that they have to put in place in Lackawanna, Luzerne, Susquehanna, and Wyoming County, in each of them a recovery support center. And that'll be that through our ROSC initiative, which stands for Recovery-Oriented Systems of Care. That's that missing piece. So when somebody comes into detox and rehab, and they're discharged from rehab and they're doing pretty well, and then they're stepped down to a lower level of care, outpatient, say, and they're expected to, attend their AA meetings and find a sponsor and attend their outpatient sessions, but they've burned a lot of bridges, you know, and they may not have family to go back to. They may be struggling with a place to live. They can't find a job. So these recovery support centers are a place for them to gather, and they can be surrounded and assisted. And at these recovery support centers, there won't just be recreational and bonding opportunities, but there will be ways there to help them build a resume, help them find a job, maybe help them find a place to live. And so
sounds
it's
like
kind
it's
of
exactly
that integral
what
part
they
of
need.
What we need, yes.
Yeah, to get people back on their feet. Jen, how is the state helping these communities like Luzerne and Wyoming counties who are working to open these treatment centers? How is the state working with these communities to help do that?
Yes, yeah, so we're working with them in a couple of different ways. One is through financial support. So we've received three different grants within the last year and a half. Two of the grants were for $26.5 million each. And most recently, we announced the receipt of a $55 million grant coming to Pennsylvania. And we're using that money for a variety of different things that range from prevention to treatment to recovery support. But there's a big chunk of that money that's going to our single county authorities, just like Steve, all across the state, for them to utilize at a local level to do a needs assessment to understand in their communities what's needed the most. So financial resources is a big one. But the other thing that we've been doing, and we did this particularly in the warm handoff space that Don mentioned earlier, is we've been helping to foster some of the relationships. What really is going to make a difference in addressing this opioid epidemic is the relationships that we're building between all the players that have to work together to make a difference. So at the state level, we've invested a lot of time and energy in terms of building those relationships, in pulling the right people together, in ensuring that everybody is sharing the same vision and mission towards what we need to accomplish.
Okay, and again, I just would like to mention the 800 number that you see on your screen. If you or someone you know needs help, please call the 1-800 hotline, 1-800-662-HELP. Earlier in the program, we did see Don talking to a young mother who struggles with cravings and temptations. And Jeremy, you've been clean for almost 2 years. How do you avoid relapsing or going back down the wrong path? And do you fear facing temptations once you get back out on your own again?
A little bit. I have that little fear. You know, I'm always a little cautious. But for the most part, I don't really have any temptations. My main focus is, like I said, my daughter. She really helps me control all that. I mean, I'm always thinking, like, if I'm having a bad day, like, you know, I still got to be that example for her. So I gotta, whatever's going on with me, I gotta fix it. I gotta get myself right and make sure that I'm the best example for her.
She keeps you motivated.
Yeah.
That's great. And Don, you counsel people, young moms. What do you say to people who are trying to get their lives back on track and are afraid of, you know, making the wrong choice again?
Yeah, I like Jeremy. I have an 8-year-old daughter, and she's a constant inspiration to me. But anytime I speak to a group of addicts or an individual mother, I always emphasize the fact that if you're a parent, you have this unique opportunity, if you're given a second chance through treatment, as I was, to really make that young person proud of you. And I think all of us who were addicts and in active addiction felt so badly about ourselves that by feeling better about yourself as an example for your child, it's easier to sustain long-term recovery. And the other thing I'd just like to mention, and maybe it's in part because I come from the world of sports statistics and all, but I always tell people the number of days I have been clean and sober, and today it's 1,812 days. And that's important to me because I remember what my life was like 1,813 days ago. But also, even with some of my addicts on the street, after they've been in detox for one day, I tell them, talk about, you know, you're one day clean and sober. You're 2 days clean and sober. And that develops a momentum and a motivational opportunity for you that not only helps you, but helps the other people who are in early recovery say, yeah, you know, I can see 3 days, I can see 4 days, and the next thing you know, you're at 1,812. And
so
I really try
going.
To encourage them. Yeah.
That's great. Steve, we were talking earlier, well, one of the reasons the PBS stations are collaborating to bring you these programs is to raise awareness and to reduce stigma. Mm-hmm. And Steve, we were talking earlier about using certain buzzwords or keywords that create the stigma, like the word addict.
Right.
We shouldn't use that word.
Yeah, one of the things that we've seen through our coalition efforts is that, you know, there are certain terms that label people. And, you know, as Don had said, you know, that you don't feel good about yourself. And somebody calls you a name, that just causes you to feel even worse about yourself. So we've become a little more politically sensitive to that. And I think, you know, that one of the highlights or positive silver linings of the opioid epidemic is that it demonstrates that substance-dependent person that we always thought of in our mind as that homeless person under the bridge. That's not true. You know, you look at the opioid epidemic, it's affecting everybody. It's the stay-at-home mom and the soccer coach and any one of us here. So it can literally affect anybody. It has no boundaries. It hits all socioeconomic platforms. It doesn't discriminate against race or ethnicity. And so that when we realize it can be any one of us, I think that we have to take that into consideration, and we just have to be there for each other and you know, be a little softer on each other and not put people down by labeling them.
That's a good tip. The Governor Wolf, declared this opioid epidemic a disaster emergency, but I just read today that the University of Pennsylvania student-run emergency response team is now equipped with Narcan. So, Jen, that has to be a good thing. That more and more people can have access to naloxone, the antidote to overdosing. Do you see more centers like that, more emergency response teams offering that around the state?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's something that we've been trying to send a message about for several years now. Is, you know, everybody in the state of Pennsylvania really should be equipped with naloxone. It doesn't matter whether you work in a treatment facility, whether you're a firefighter, whether you're a parent, or whether you're just a concerned community citizen. Everyone should have access to this drug because you really just don't know when you might need to use it. And every life is worth saving, truly. So we've done a lot of things from a government level in terms of Act 139 that allows access for first responders, for individuals to go to pharmacies and pick up this drug. And Governor Wolf, in last year's budget, gave $5 million worth of state funds to give free naloxone to what we call first responders. When you look at the definition of a first responder, it's really pretty broad. It can be just about anybody. So, you know, we try to get the word out there from the state perspective that organizations who need to have this, schools, libraries, treatment providers, they can get this drug for free. I mean, there shouldn't be any limitation for being able to access the medication. And so if you've already used it, please don't hesitate to ask for a second time. If you don't know what the medication is, check out the Department of Health's website. They have a great training video on there that shows you how to use it. The nasal version is so easy. It's just like using Flonase or some kind of nasal spray. So they have great training resources, and there's also information on there about Act 139, which is the standing order from the state physician general that allows any member of the public to go to a pharmacy and receive the prescription for naloxone.
But that you have to pay for.
In some cases, yes. In some cases, no. It depends what insurance you have as to whether there's any portion of payment required.
Do you think the fact that Narcan is so readily available that it is making the epidemic worse, or do you think it's helping alleviate it?
Oh, I definitely don't think it's worse. There were certainly some stories circulating out there a year or maybe less than a year ago about Narcan parties and people with substance use disorder were collecting Narcan and then having these parties, and they would use drugs and then Narcan each other, and it was this great excuse to continue to utilize drugs. And really, that's such a falsehood. It really isn't true at all. When you get to know individuals with substance use disorder, none of them want to die. None of them want to overdose. That's just a byproduct of the brain disease that is addiction. So I absolutely believe that it's helping. In the state of Pennsylvania, we're aware of over 9,200 reversals by both police and EMS just within the last few years. And that certainly is a floor. That's only what we're aware of. There are many police departments and EMS stations that haven't reported their data to us. So if you just think about that number alone, 9,200 times someone's life has been saved because of this drug, I think it's just phenomenal. And I think we need to continue to get the word out there about the importance of this drug and the availability of it.
Okay.
I can tell you locally, we lost 163 residents in Luzerne County last year to an opioid overdose. Our office supplied the Wilkes-Barre Fire Department with naloxone last year, and Chief Jay Delaney reported to me that he administered in 2017 over 415 doses to people on the street. So when you think about that, if we didn't have that in place, that number 163, as tragic as it is, would have been over 500.
Correct.
That's how important Narcan is. You know, and I've got to applaud, you know, Jen Smith and DDAP and the Department of Health and the governor himself with his passion toward, you know, putting these things in place. We have these CCEs through PCCD, the centralized coordinating entities that have it available for first responders, and getting that out there is literally helping us save lives on a daily basis.
Again, if you or someone you know needs help, please call the 1-800 number that you see on your screen, 1-800-662-HELP. And speaking of getting help, Jeremy, we were talking about this earlier, that another new initiative with police departments is, and this happened to you, instead of charging a person with substance abuse, they offer them to go to treatment right away. So it's an incentive to get better. Instead of sending them off to crowded jails, they're offered treatment. Is that's what got you into Hogar Crea, right, Jeremy?
Well, I went before I knew about my legal situation, but it benefited me because I was in treatment. Instead of doing jail time, I was able to stay in the program, and they gave me a break with not being on going to jail. I mean. So I
because
was able
you're...
to complete the program. I was able to just have some probation and some restitution and fines. And, you know, it was settled up, you know, instead of sitting in jail and then having to go to treatment after I did my time. They caught me a huge break.
Because your wife did end up going to jail.
Correct, yes.
So with the time that we have remaining, what words of encouragement can you offer people out there who are struggling with this disease, and what would you like to say to them?
I think the thing is that every addict that I've ever been involved with, and myself included obviously, lives in a world of denial and delusion and all. But there's also this resistance and reluctance to accept help, you know, and I really think that if you have an attitude that you can either do this by yourself, or that you're ashamed to ask for help, or both combined, you're really going to position yourself for more and more life-threatening trouble. So my advice, really, most of all, to the families of people who are either at risk or maybe come at risk very soon, is to make sure that the stories of recovery of people like the ones who were in this great documentary that you folks at Public Media put together are very, very possible and doable for anybody. But you just got to come down off your high horse of active addiction and say, I can do this, and I can do it with the help of people who care.
But you have to want to do it, right, Jeremy?
Yeah, I mean, that's a big thing. You have to want to do it. You got to want it. I tried getting help a bunch of times, but I didn't really want to change. And it took until I wanted to change for me really to change. But accept the help. Don't be ashamed of being too stubborn to get help. A lot of good things are going to happen when you get help.
That's great.
You're going to get in contact with family. People are going to be proud of you again. That's, all good things. It's going to make you feel better than anything.
Yeah.
You know?
I appreciate you all coming here, and I commend you all in your efforts and how you're trying to recover and get people back on the right track in our communities.
Thank you, Paula.
If you need help, please call the 800 number on your screen, 1-800-662-HELP. And thank you again for joining us for this important program. I would like to thank our panel members for being a part of this important discussion. This program is the first in a series of programs where Pennsylvania public media organizations have come together to bring awareness to this statewide crisis. Our hope is that through our efforts, our citizens will have access to information on where to get help and to save lives. On behalf of Pennsylvania Public Media, I'm Paola Giangiacomo. Thank you for watching.
Major funding for Battling Opioids has been provided by...
It doesn't take long to become addicted to opioids. In fact, 13 Pennsylvanians die from them every day. Geisinger is committed to ending opioid addiction with both prevention and treatment. In the last 3 years, we've reduced the amount of opioids we prescribe by 50%, and we've opened 3 medication-assisted treatment centers to help patients recover from addiction. Learn more at geisinger.org/hadenough.
Additional support has been provided by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and viewers like you. Thank you.